Welcome to our service this morning. It is so good to see, to have Kim Ketzel back with us this morning. Welcome. And it's special to have Brad Yeager here with us as well. Welcome to our services and to all who are joining us this morning. I just want to call your attention to the card that's in the seat in front of you. We ask that you would fill it out with your name and the date and put it in the offering plate as you leave. It's our way of taking attendance. If you have a prayer request that you would like for us to pray for at the end of the service today, write your prayer request on this card and hold your card up. The ushers will come and collect that card for us to be able to pray at the end of the service today. So for our call to worship this morning, since Wayne is going to be talking to us from Ephesians, I chose a call to worship from the book of Ephesians as well. Ephesians chapter 3, a prayer for the Ephesus church. For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all of the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Let's stand for a word of prayer. Lord God, we come before you this morning as your gathered church, gathered to worship you, to give honor and glory and praise to your name. We thank you for giving us another day, Lord God, and we pray that our worship will be pleasing to you. In your precious name we pray. I pray. Amen. Turn around and wave a greeting to those behind you as the worship team comes.
Sorry for the technical difficulties. Psalm 107, verses 1 and 2 says, "Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord tell their story, those he redeemed from the hand of the foe." We have many reasons to praise the Lord this morning. And this song says we should have 10,000 of them. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Oh, my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Your holy name. The sun comes up.
The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name.
You're rich in love.
You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Oh, my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I'll worship Your holy name.
And
on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Oh, my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Lord, I'll worship Your holy name. Lord, I'll worship Your holy name.
Sing like never.
Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. Lord, I'll worship Your holy name. Lord, I'll worship Your holy name.
Shout it aloud. Do not hold back. Raise your voice like a trumpet. Declare to my people their rebellion and to the descendants of Jacob their sins. Isaiah 58:1.
I raise
a hallelujah
in the presence of my enemy.
I raise a hallelujah
louder than the unbelief.
I raise a hallelujah.
My weapon is a melody.
I raise a hallelujah.
Heaven comes to fight for me.
I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. I raise a hallelujah
with everything inside of me.
I raise a hallelujah.
I will watch the darkness flee.
I raise a hallelujah
in the middle of the mystery.
I raise a hallelujah.
Fear, you lost your hold on me.
I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm, louder and louder, gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive.
Louder,
sing a little louder,
sing a little louder,
sing louder than the unbelief.
Sing a little louder.
My weapon is a melody.
Sing a little louder.
Heaven comes to fight for me.
Sing a little louder.
In the presence of my enemies.
Sing a little louder.
Louder than the unbelief.
Sing a little louder.
My weapon is a melody.
Sing a little louder.
Heaven comes to fight for me. Sing a little louder. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder. Gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, up will arise. Death is defeated. The King is alive. I raise a hallelujah. You are here. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship. Let's do that again as a prayer. You are here. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are waymaker, miracle worker. Promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker. Promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are here.
You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship you. Worship you. You are
waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. That is who you are. 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 That is who you are.
God can be a chain breaker. God can be a way maker. God can be, and God is, the answer to our prayers. In this time of unknown, of civil unrest, in times of sickness and coronavirus, God wants to be our way maker. This next song is Chainbreaker. You know what? I'm ignoring my own outline. Let's go ahead and sit down, and I apologize. I skipped over Wanda coming and praying for the offering, and I just realized that. So, Wanda, would you please come?
Part of Wayne's text this morning is taken from Ephesians chapter 4. And in that chapter, it talks about God giving each of us gifts, and we each need to do our part to make a healthy, growing church. And we can also apply that in an area of giving. It takes each one of us to give our tithes and offerings in order to be a healthy, growing church. And I'm going to read just the last verse 16 of chapter Ephesians 4. For him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work, as each one of us does our part in giving. I'm going to pray a prayer blessing on our offering. Lord God, each of us is here to do our part in your kingdom, with the gifts that you give us, with the blessings you give us. Financially, we give back a portion of that to support the work of the church so that your church will continue to grow. Father, I ask that you bless each one. I ask that you bless the gift. In your precious name I pray, amen.
I want to apologize to my sound crew in the back. I went out of order. I did not read my notes. For you guys, I'm going to do, we're going to do the reading now, Braden, the Psalm 23, and then we're going to do No Longer Slaves, and then do Chainbreaker. So I got all mixed up. My papers got all shuffled up here. So let's read the 23rd Psalm together as a church. I know maybe we have learned different versions, so if you have it memorized by a different version and you just want to say it that way, I won't hold it against you. But I do have the words up on the screen if we want to all try to read this version. Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Thank you.
no longer slaves. You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
You split
the sea so I could walk right through it. My veins were drowned in perfect love. You rescued me so I could stand and sing. I am a child of God.
You split the sea
so I could walk right through it. My fears were drowned in perfect love. You rescued me so I could stand and sing. I am a child of God. I am a child of God.
One more. I am
a child.
We all may have things that we struggle giving up and give over to God, but He can be our chain breaker. He can be the one that takes over those things that we don't want to give up.
If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice till the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you've got pain, He's a pain taker. If you feel lost, He's a way maker. If you live rid of a saving, He's a present shaking savior. If you've got chains, He's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know that just ain't right. Well, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you've got pain, He's a pain taker. If you feel lost, He's a way maker. You need freedom of saving. He's a present shaking savior. If you've got chains, He's a chain breaker. If you believe it,
if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you've got pain, needs a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. You need freedom, a saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you've got chains, he's a chain breaker. If you need freedom, a saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you've got chains, he's a chain breaker.
Thank you. At this time, I believe, Eric, are you prepared to read? Eric is going to read Wayne's scripture, and this morning our message is going to be brought to us by Wayne Yeager, who's on the leadership team here at church, and Eric will be reading the morning's scripture.
We will also dismiss children grade 5 and under to have an activity in the fellowship hall. So if you feel comfortable, feel free to meet April in the fellowship hall. For Wayne's sermon text this morning, I will be reading from Ephesians 4, 1 through 16, and it is on the back of your program if you would like to follow along. As a prisoner of the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope, and when you were called, one Lord, one faith, and one baptism. One God and Father of all, who is over all, through all, and in all. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. This is why it says, when he ascended on high, he took many captives and gave gifts to his people. What does he ascended mean except that he also descended to the lower earthly region? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. So Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors and teachers to equip his people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, and become mature, attaining the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves, blown here and there by every wind of teaching, and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful schemes. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow and become in every respect, the mature body of him who is the head, that is Christ. From him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. Wayne, won't you come forward? And I'd like to pray for you as you begin here this morning. Father, I thank you for your servant, Wayne. I thank you for the good work that you have done in his life and are continuing to do. I thank you for the message that you've laid on his heart. I pray that your spirit move this morning. Use Wayne as your voice to us this morning And I pray that your Spirit open our ears and our hearts to receive your message, that you want to speak to each one of us. Lord, won't you come and do a powerful move this morning? Humble us, Lord, and awaken us to your Spirit. Lord, I ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, worship team, for singing those songs, and those songs have meant a lot to me and mean a lot to me, and it's good to see everybody here. Nate and Kim, it's good to see you, and everybody else. It's just great to be a part of the kingdom of God. Maybe before we start, I just wanted to say maybe people are wondering about Charles. I got a text from Charles yesterday at 2:05 our time. Charles said, we're packed, we're just leaving Seattle. So 3,126 mile, he'll be here with two children, with a wife and two children. He, for those who don't know, he'll be living at, for the temporary time being, he'll be living at 1611 Philadelphia Avenue. It's the house right in front of Chambers Point, or more commonly known as Penn Hall. Menahaven owns the house, and we've been grateful enough to secure that house for them till they settle for their own home. So we'll continue to pray for Charles and Becca and the children as they travel that many miles. He doesn't have a time limit to be here. I thought if he drove 500 mile a day with children, he would be here in 6 days. But I don't know if he'll drive that far or not. So greetings again in Jesus' name. It's great to be a part of the kingdom of God. I wanted, you look at this passage we have, and it's probably one of the toughest passages to understand, and I've been looking at this for a couple weeks, and I've said, Lord, what do you have in here for us? So I'm looking at the title of the message is The Power to Change, or Change from the Inside Out. You know, I want you to think back a little bit to several months ago, to maybe December, around Christmas time in that area, and you know, you begin to think about the new year. And what's the first thing you do when you begin to think about new year? You begin to think about making a new year's resolution. And you look at that and you say, well, you know what, I want to learn to exercise more. So I'm beginning January, I'm going to exercise more, or I'm going to, you know, maybe I'm overweight, or I just need to lose a little weight, so I'm going to lose weight. Or you may say you know what, you're going to start reading the Bible more. You're going to start spending less time on the internet, on Facebook. You're going to get out of debt. You get all these resolutions, New Year's resolutions, and you make them, and you're excited about them. January first comes, and you do it one day, and then something else will show up. But you know what, the reality of it is that about 97% of your resolutions proved to be a flash in the pan. In the end, we don't lose weight, we don't exercise more, we don't get into God's word more, we don't spend less time on the internet, we don't get out of debt. Usually by February or March, what we started in January is gone. Why is that? Why is that? You know, Paul, in his letter to the Ephesian church here, starts out in chapter 1, Paul to the saints in Ephesus, God chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world. In chapter 1, we are redeemed through Christ's blood. In chapter 2, he made you alive who were dead in the trespasses of sin. In chapter 3, Paul's a prisoner, Gentiles and fellow heirs to the hidden mystery of God. And then he comes to chapter 4. And the central thought here of this letter is that Jesus has brought to a disunited world the way to unity. You know, I thought, Lord, we're living in a disunited world. And the way to unity is through faith in him, and it's the church's task to proclaim this message to all the world. In chapter 4, Paul turns to the character of the Christian must have if the church is to fulfill her great task of being Christ's internet of universal reconciliation between man to man and man to God. You know, I think about, you talk about faith, and you talk about faith and fear, and the two can't mix. You know, you look at the story of David and Goliath. When David faced Goliath, he didn't talk about how bad and dangerous Goliath was. He talked about how great his God is. You don't talk fear, he talked faith. I think of Daniel in the lion's den. You know, he didn't say, man, those big bad lions down there, there's no way I'm gonna start obeying the king. There's no way I want to go into that thing. But Daniel didn't. He had faith. He had faith in God. But even more significant than that is the people who claim to be Christians and claim Christ as their personal Savior, and whose lifestyle shows little difference from those who make no such claims. It's so common that we no longer think it's all strange that someone who says they are Christian goes out and will get drunk or talk like the world or engage in immorality like the world, struggles with rage like the world, divorces at the same rate as the world, and does business like the world, yet all the while saying and believing that Jesus has delivered them from this world and that the sins they are persisting in are forgiven and heaven-bound. Taking these patterns down to a personal level, there are some here who struggle and agonize to be free from a weakness, from habits, from sinful patterns that took root in your life prior to your coming to know Christ. Yet years into your walk with Christ, after multiple tries and much prayer, you remain unchanged. Why is that? What's missing? Wow, what's missing? You know, this morning we want to hear from God about the power to change. This morning, I'm going to show you the resources that are already yours in Christ, where you can break free from the fleshly patterns that have a grip on us. Verse 1, if you look at it, speaks of walking worthy of his calling we have received. You know, that phrase pictures a great scale to walk worthy. On one side, in which you put all that Jesus has done for you and is for you, and then you step on the other side and of the scale, and walking worthy means that both sides will balance. In other words, my behavior, my attitudes, my words, even my inner thoughts are the outer working of what Christ has done in me. You know, I think about this walking worthy and how you balance that. You know, if you take one of these old stand-up scales, I don't know if you know what I'm talking about, you step on them and you got a little bar here, you put a weight across, and when that little thing balances there, that's how much you weigh. That's how much weight there is. You know, and that's sort of like balancing life and walking worthy. Walking worthy in life. In verse 2, he talks about a couple things. He talks about what will it look like. He showed us what life will look like when you're walking worthy. You'll be humble rather than self-centered, gentle rather than argumentative, patient rather than reactionary, and forbearing rather than judgmental toward other people. We'll be the sort of people who will generate a harmony with those around us. Verse 3 to 6 describes so many of the sinful habits and patterns we are losing the battle with, have to do with these four attitudes. You know, when we're losing the battle in life, it's because we have lost our humility. We've lost our gentleness. We've lost our patience. We've become reactionary and forbearing rather than judgmental, you know, being judgmental. So to think about that, we have to go on here to verse 7 and 10, which is really the main theme, of this whole scripture verse here. You know, you look at this passage, and Paul writing to the Ephesian church, and it's something I never really thought about until I got to looking at this passage. What happened when Jesus died? What happened where was Jesus at between his death and his resurrection? You ever think about that? Was Jesus in heaven? Was Jesus alive? Where was Jesus at between his death and his resurrection? He was in the grave, but where was his soul? You know, you look at this this couple of verses here in verse 7 to 10 actually take us to one of the most mysterious periods of Jesus' life, and that was this period between his death and his resurrection. And how can that help me break long-standing addictions or long-standing habits that need to be broken? Or deeply wounds that have been in my life that really need changed. If you're really for real life, for real change in Christ, take a glimpse beyond the grave and find out. Verse 7 says, Now grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of the Messiah's gift. Verse 8 says, for when he ascended on high, he took prisoners into captivity, and he gave gifts to people. But what does he ascended mean except that he descended to the lower parts of the earth? The one who descended is the same as the one who ascended far above the heavens, that he might fill all things. So let's look at what it would take to make some lasting changes in our life. Point one, every Christian can change. When you know, growing up, we were taught to, if you do something, you do a little extra. Did you ever do a little extra for somebody? They ask you to do something, and then you just did a little more than what they ask. Well, you know, when you were saved, Jesus gave you, he saved your soul. He gave you a saving grace, but along with that, he gave you a serving grace. Verse 7 reads again, now grace was given to each of us according to the measure of the Messiah's gift. To every true believer, Jesus gives the capacity, the enabling, the supernatural ability to pass on grace to others. He works in you so that you become a conduit of his goodness in the lives of others. He rewires your inner being. You know, sometimes I've bought an old house, and you know what it needs? It needs rewired. You look at some of these houses, their wires are going everywhere. But you know what? And you come to Jesus, he rewires you. And that rewiring is up to date, and it's good. He can work passing grace on so that others are strengthened, encouraged, and given wisdom. When you were saved, Jesus reworked your inner world so that you can make an effective and significant impact for Jesus' sake. And notice the personal touch in the last part of that verse. This grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of the Messiah's gift. Jesus acts out of his own generosity, exactly tailoring this gift of grace to fit who you are. In other words, this serving grace will not be a strain on you. It meshes with your unique personality, bringing about God's glory and great joy in your life. You know, sometimes we hear people in the church and they say, man, you know, it's such a strain on me to teach Sunday school, or it's such a strain on me to do that. You know what? God gave us that ability. It shouldn't be a strain on us. It should be a joy serving Jesus in that capacity, whatever he calls you to, whatever he's blessed you with. And here it is again in Scripture. Every Christian can change. You know, you look at a caterpillar. It can change. You know, you see a caterpillar crawling along, and all of a sudden that caterpillar doesn't get a vote. It will become a butterfly. It doesn't have a choice. It doesn't try on cocoon after cocoon to see if the idea is good before moving in. God has built that transformation into its very essence. In the same way, Christians are changed from the inside out. You're meant to fly. Jesus equipped you to experience the abundant life of glorifying God in all you do. So anytime you hear someone who claims to be a Christian say, I can't help the way I am. I've tried, but it just doesn't work for me. You know, there's a disconnection somewhere. Either they're confused, or maybe haven't been really converted. So think of the place in your life where you struggled and repeatedly failed. Look at that person next to you and say, God's not finished with me yet. I can change. Change is not young or not old. It's in life. Change comes through all of life. Point number two is life change was secured by Jesus. Let us walk a little bit through some unfamiliar territory. We're going to think that maybe I'm off point here a little bit for a few minutes, but this is the very heart of transformation into Christ's likeness. Verse 8 takes us to the Old Testament, to an Old Testament quotation from Psalm 68. For based on God's eternal intention to give the gift of grace to each believer through Christ, it says, when he ascended on high, he took many captives and he gave gifts to people. We cannot understand what this means unless we grasp what really David talked about in Psalm 68. David wrote it and drew an analogy from battle. You know, in Psalm 68, David wrote, if you talk about giving gifts, when David went to war, he captured or defeated the enemy, they would have a march, they would have a big parade down the middle of town, and David would lead the way all in his attire, and then his army, and they would be all dressed up and be marching, and people would be cheering on both sides. Then would come the prisoners that they had freed from the enemy, and they were behind them. And then would come the defeated king and his army. And they were trodden along, and people were booing them, and just they were the bad people. They were in chains. They were defeated. And then behind that came wagons and horses and cattle and many loads of gold and silver, everything that they had taken from the defeated army. And when they got to the palace, they would give out gifts to everyone. They would give out gifts, and one by one, the people would be given some token of the king's victory, which serves as a constant reminder of the triumph over a formidable foe. You know, when Jesus, he gives us a gift, the Holy Spirit, the serving grace. Why? As a token, as a victory, to know that Jesus conquered death. In Ephesians 4:8, describes a processional led by Jesus. When he ascended on high, he led the captives and he gave gifts to men. And who were the captives? You know, we don't know. Well, this may have happened between Jesus' death and his resurrection. But those who were dead in Christ, I believe Jesus led them and gave gifts to them. There was a tremendous battle had just been won. Jesus had just died and conquered death. What a great victory. What a great victory. And he gave us the Holy Spirit. The final battle ensued atop a hill outside of Jerusalem. There, suspended from the earth on a cross, Jesus unfolded the most surprising and unusual strategy ever conceived, so thoroughly taking our sin in his body that the Bible says he became sin along with the curse of God sin brings, and then paying the penalty in full by his willing and innocent death in our place. In response to Colossians 2:15, Colossians 2:15 tells us that God disarmed the rulers, and having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. So King Jesus has this processional and led to heaven, and the shattered forces of the enemy, and he also leads a host of captives. We'll explain more on that in a moment. And finally, he gave gifts to people. Along with the gift of the Holy Spirit, Jesus gave that serving grace to each believer as a token reminder of his triumph. So when you think about the saving grace of Jesus, the serving grace of Jesus, it's a gift. It's a gift to each one of us as a token of what he did for us on the cross. But then don't miss what happened after that battle. Verse 9 tells us that he descended, he come back down to the lower earthly regions, and we'll explain more on that in a minute, but he gave gifts to people along with the gift of the Holy Spirit, and Jesus gave serving grace to each believer as a token reminder of his triumph. What we don't know, the geography in mind, we get a hint from about what he was doing in 1 Peter 3, verse 18 and 19, where we read that he was put to death in the fleshly realm, but made alive in the spiritual realm. In that state, he also went and made a proclamation to the spirits in prison. So while they were burying his dead body on earth, his spirit was very active. In the days of the Old Testament and the Gospels, the Bible gives us a brief glimpse into the place where the dead go while they wait for the final judgment of God. Jesus referred to this in Luke 16. As he focused on the deaths of the rich man and Lazarus, when the rich man died, he said he went to a place of torment, which is the place of those lost in sin. Lazarus died and went to what Jesus called Abraham's side, or paradise, the place where those made righteous by God. Peter says it's this place that Jesus went and proclaimed what had happened. Jesus went sometime right after his death. He announced his credentials. He declared his victory. This was the rest of what his "it is finished" on the cross meant. He had fulfilled God's will. He had broken sin's power. He won the battle. He makes his proclamation to those who believe in God's promise of provision for sin in a coming Messiah. And he declares his triumph to those who have rejected God. To some, this was a message of unspeakable joy. To others, it sealed their doom. Jesus went to the place of the dead, but not to stay, but to tear the gates of death off its hinges. The implication here and elsewhere is that he emptied paradise of those who trusted in the coming Messiah and led them home in this processional that he's talking about here in Ephesians. Okay, we get it. Jesus won. But how does that help me? How does that help me? How does that help me to change? Point number three, it's time to act on the truth. All of us have seen what happens when it rains. When it rains, water runs to the lowest point. When it rains out here, the water runs down under the road, down to the road, and it ends up down at the lowest point in the Frank Road. Why? Because water takes a path of least resistance. I remember Aldous Lehman up here preaching one Sunday and said, you know what, the Warm Spring Road is the high point, one of the high points in this county. Everything to the east runs to the Conococjig, and to the west it runs to Back Creek. And you think about that. Water runs to the point of least resistance. Let it rain enough and the water run off, it will cut a groove in the dirt. And years of that groove can become a trench, and hundreds of years of that trench can become a riverbed. So you think about it, how do you stop water from flowing down the path of least resistance? You dam it up. You make another path. How do you stop temptation from traveling down the well-worn path to sin it has found in you? You dam it up with what? Think about that. How do you dam that temptation that's coming? You know, if you go back to our Conquer series, the men had that, and we had a lesson called, it was Lesson on the Brain, and how our brain functions. You know, the front part of our brain is the prefrontal cortex. And I'm going to read a little bit from the Conquer series. It's where higher reasoning takes place. It's our brain's chief commander in the front of our brain. And then behind that is the limbic part of our brain. And that's the brain that is emotional. That's the brain that is the survival system and operates on impulse and is subconscious level. It overpowers the prefrontal cortex of our brain during times of fight or flight. This is our emotional part of our brain, where emotional memories are stored. So what happens during this time of stress or anger in an addict's brain? or in when we're facing temptation. The limbic system will overpower our ability to think. Your brain produces many chemicals, and among them is dopamine, which people know about if you have Parkinson's. Your brain no longer produces dopamine, which is a transmitter and helps to regulate emotional responses, enabling us to identify rewards and take action. You know, you look at that, and Paul Cole wrote, it says, whatever attracts and holds your attention will eventually control the direction of your life. Think about that. Whatever attracts and holds your attention will eventually control the direction of your life. We talked a little bit earlier when I started about having a New Year's resolution. You know, we start off, and New Year's Day we get up, and we're here, and we have all these great things we're going to do this year. And if you're here, that's great. It means you're accepting life on God's terms, because we trust that God has led you in those decisions. God's terms with trust, vulnerability, and gratitude. This is where we want to live. But then a couple days later, something happens. We get up, we get busy, and we forget our priorities. We say, I get up late, I got to run. I'm not going to do my devotions this morning. I'm not going to read my Bible. I'll do it later on today. Here's where we start to believe that our present circumstances begin to define our life, and we begin to move away from trusting God. We fall back into denial. We avoid and blame others, and our priorities start to change. When that happens, this begins to lead to anxiety. Why? Because I'm not doing what God wanted me to do. This is where we become fearful and anxious, and our emotions begin to control us. Now, you slide further down the scale. The more you are limbically and emotionally reactive, this begins to speed up your life. Now you're trying to outrun anxiety, where depression and feelings of inadequacy and worthlessness come to the surface. And this can lead to you being all upset. You're getting an adrenaline high from anger and aggressive behaviors, and this can lead to exhaustion. The adrenaline's wearing off, and you're on the brink of relapse, and you're running out of physical, emotional energy. And all of a sudden, you are where you was on December the 31st. You're back, right back. You've lost everything that you had. You say, how does that connect to my life? Romans 6, 1 to 4 says, what should we say then? Should we continue in sin in order that grace may multiply? Absolutely not. How can we, who died to sin, still live in it? Or are you unaware that all of us were baptized into Christ? Jesus was baptized into his death. Therefore, we were buried with him by baptism into his death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too may walk in a new way of life. Breaking free from the dominant power of sin is not an option for me as a Christian, because everything Jesus accomplished on the cross and the resurrection applies to me. He died for sins. I died to sin. He was raised victorious. I am victorious. Amen? You say, how do I get to the bottom line on this? And how does that enable me to change, to become more Christ-like? Just this way. You are linked to Christ. In what he has won, going back to verse 7 to 10, he has given each of us grace. He's given each of us the Holy Spirit. He's given each of us a serving grace. Ephesians 7 to 10 here describes a moment in objective history when your spiritual freedom and transformation was accomplished. Christ died on the cross, rose again, and it's a done deal. He won. He won. He won the victory. You say, if that's so, why do I lose more than I win? One of two reasons. We either aren't a true believer, or we have not believed that the victory Jesus gained was also your victory. The victory Jesus gained is not just his, it's ours. It's a victory we can claim. It's a victory we need. The question either way is, do you believe that? Do you believe the victory Jesus got is my victory also? Do you believe that? The fight against sin is called the fight of faith. You change by trusting that Jesus has already beaten your worst enemy. You change. You talk about the power to change. You change by believing and knowing that Jesus has defeated your worst enemy, which is Satan. He beat him. He died and he rose again. He defeated Satan. Do you believe? Do you believe that this morning? Do you believe that you can change because Jesus has beaten your worst enemy? Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for your death and your resurrection. You arose and give tremendous victory to your people, to believers. So, Lord, we claim that victory this morning, that you've beaten the worst enemy that we have, and that's Satan. And, Lord, you have died and rose again, and you led a processional into heaven, and you took the saints there. Lord, I thank you for the resurrection because it has given me the power to change. Lord, I think of Mark 11 where it says, have faith in God. And whatever you ask in prayer, believe that you've received it and it will be yours. And when you're praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive him so that your Father will forgive you. Lord, it's a joy to serve you. It's a joy to be in your kingdom. It's a joy to be a part of your kingdom right here on earth. So, Lord, we thank you for the lesson this morning of the power to change. Lord, you have given us all we need. And, Lord, we claim it for each one here this morning that the joy and the serving will be ours. Lord, we thank you for this day. I thank you, Lord, for your church. I thank you, Lord, for the worship this morning. I thank you, Lord, for each one who's been a part, for each person that's here. And Lord, I pray that if each one is someone's here this morning and they don't feel right, Lord, then they lose more than they win. Lord, I ask that you would check their hearts, that they would look at do they really believe that God can make a difference in their life. So, Lord, we thank you for each one here, and we'll praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Wayne, for that message on the power to change from the inside out. There's a couple of prayer announcements I want to give this morning. We want to remember the Lou Stern family. Lou and Vicki Stern at one time had attended our church, and Vicki passed away on Friday. And so we would want to hold Lou and their daughters Mandy and Abby and their grandchildren before the Lord. We also want to continue to hold Pastor Charles and Becca and their sons as they travel this week. And also want to pray for Wayne, who has upcoming surgery this week. So let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for your message this morning through Wayne. And I pray that each one of us takes that with us this week, realizing that we have the power, your power, living in us to change us from the inside out. We believe and we know that you defeated Satan on the cross, and so we have that same power within us. Help us to carry that with us through this week and everything that we do and decisions that we need to make. Father, I pray that you'll be with Lou and his family. Father, it's tough to lose your mate, to lose your mom, to lose your grandmother. Father, just be with them, be near to them, be their peace, be their comfort. Help us as a praying community to continue to hold them up in the days and weeks ahead as they grieve the passing of Vicki. Father, we want to also hold Pastor Charles to you and their family as they are traveling. We pray for traveling mercies. We pray for safety. We pray that all goes well as he travels east to Pennsylvania. We pray for their transition, for the settlement of a new home, for settling in, and for all that that encompasses. Lord, we just hold him up to you. And Father, we just pray for Wayne as he goes this week for surgery, Lord, that you would go before him, that you would give the doctors wisdom and performing the surgery, Father, and that it will be all taken care of, and that you will bring healing and be with Susan as she takes care of Wayne in the days following the surgery. Lord God, we just thank you and praise you and for all that you have done for us. In your precious name I pray, amen. The worship team has a closing song.
I'd ask you to stand for a closing song. When Wayne mentioned that he was going to be speaking on the power to change, the verse, the song that came to my mind was, there's power in the blood. The power to change comes through Jesus' blood and his sacrifice. So that's what came to mind. We'll be singing all four verses of There's Power in the Blood.
Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be whiter, much whiter than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Sin stains are lost in its life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you do service for Jesus, your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily his praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
As a quick reminder, we are going to continue to plan on having one service on Sunday mornings at 10 a.m. For those of you that can't attend, you can call in at 10 a.m. live to listen to it on the phone or later Sunday afternoon or evening. It will be posted on YouTube. At this point, the ushers will come and dismiss by the front and be willing to go out and social distance and greet everybody. We'll be singing the chorus as you go.
There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood.